right? All right, we'll do some introductions. Before we do, just some housekeeping, assuming this is being filmed. All of you standing in the back, can't find seats, you can pull forward, it's fine, we'll find your seat. No problems. Okay, so my name is Joel Wallenstrom. I am currently the CEO at Wickr, which is, appropriately for this talk, an ephemeral communications company. Prior to that, I worked at a company called At Stake. Any hands in the air heard of At Stake before? Okay. And then when we sold At Stake to Symantec, some friends and I started a company called iSec Partners. I think what is relevant about that history is that in the, 10 years of doing our work, we had 100%, or if not 100%, very close to 100% success rate getting to all the data everyone here is trying to protect. You know, if we were ever given that objective, we got it. And so sometimes it was protected more, sometimes less. But, you know, the reality is it's very hard to defend against advanced adversaries. And so, I don't know, you know, that history of mine made me think about what are the values of having less to protect. And maybe that's a way to treat things differently. The other thing, if I've done one thing that's been very successful in my life, it's that in those companies, I surrounded myself by the smartest people in the world. And that's no different than my experience today. I've got Paul here.
I think Joel's the smart one here. But so I have founded and ran a company called Cryptography Research for many years. So I've been had sort of one set of hands in the power outlet of trying to build systems, and then my other hands have been causing pain for other people who are trying to do that. So I've developed and identified various kinds of vulnerabilities, often working at kind of a hardware layer. I've also worked on protocols, so the SSL3 protocol, when you were cursing that or having to upgrade something, and that's probably my fault. So we're excited to be here together. So maybe, Joel, you'll start out by telling us what ephemerality is.
Yeah, and so some apologies to Jade during the introduction. We stumped you with this word ephemeral, right? And so, you know, as a company that's in this business, I understand how non-accessible this concept of ephemeral is. It's relatively new in our world of computer security, computing, et cetera. But it's a, you know, it's a kind of a time-honored word in general. It means short-lived. That's what Webster's would tell us here on the screen. And, you know, for us and for the purposes of this presentation and the way I think we collectively view this in terms of computing, it just means not persistent, right? And so when we intentionally limit the lifespan of something, and which begs the question of why would we do that, okay?
So ephemeral for us could mean a millisecond, or it could mean a few years.
Yeah.
But it means not forever. And just the difference between not forever and some amount of time less than that immediately starts forcing you to think the way we're going to be talking about here.
Yep. And we are going to have an issue because autoplay is on here, but we'll try and I'll stay on top of this. So why would we minimize persistence? So look, when you look at infrastructure, obviously as engineering folks in computer engineering, we've been accustomed to trying to build things that last, that are very sturdy and that are protected and that are hardened and that, you know, can kind of they don't wear down with time, but that's hard, right? There are things that make that more difficult. There are crashes, there are outages. Scaling becomes a problem for us when we do that. When we think about persistent data, it's somewhat similar. You have all this data, you know, there's data corruption, you have database issues, sync issues, all these things that come with long-term persistence and scalability. So that's, you know, that can be expensive. That can be more moving pieces. There's also risk and there's danger, obviously. And that usually comes in the form of persistence. So if anyone can remember, who was here in 2009? RSA, right after the Aurora attacks, right? Mm-hmm. And everything on the exhibit floor had a, you know, anti-APT sticker, right? Like it was, I've got an APT USB device. I've got an APT this, I've got an APT that. But, you know, as much as that's kind of kitschy, that is still real, right? Like we have advanced persistent threats. And when I look at this, this is going to be interesting for us, Paul. I look at this acronym of APT where, you know, advanced, right? It's going to be difficult for defenders to be more advanced than the offense. This is just one of the things that we have to come to grips with. Threats are going to be there as economies grow, as technologies change. We're just going to have to deal with that. So we have some control over persistence, and ephemerality is one of those things we can do to control persistence. And I know how to control this problem with the slide. So here, you take that, and while you're talking, I'm going to do this.
So this idea of having ephemeral computation is not a new thing. In fact, almost all of our computations were very ephemeral in the past. So if we go back to the original IBM PC, you put your floppy disks in, the instructions were you put them in the safe when you leave at work at night, and there's no persistence in the computer. Its state at the end, when it's powered off, is always the same. And then hard disks came along, and in some ways, hard disks are kind of the root of all evil, because they integrated our compute and our persistence of our data and made it so that we have all kinds of different things with different threat perimeters and different security requirements all piled together in the same machine. And that was fine when we didn't care about security, and there was an era where creating functionality was more economically important than securing that functionality. We're past that era now. So if we look at the modern systems that are getting being built now, people are actually trying to get back to some of these ephemerality notions. So we look at things like Amazon Lambda, where you can go run a computation on an instance, and at least the claim that Amazon gives you is that that instance will spin up, do something useful with your data, do some compute, give you the results, but then vanish. So it comes and it goes. We also see the same kind of philosophy around microservices, where you have components that may come into existence briefly, may work on some transaction briefly, and then go away. Even with EC2 and other kinds of cloud services, we can create things and destroy them much more easily than we could before. We're also seeing this at a smaller level. So within computers, we have within our processors, we have things like enclaves where, well, we can argue about what the right design approach is. The concept, though, of having some place where you can go run a computation in a closed environment, work for a while, and then shut it down safely is starting to come back. We also see even in programming languages, like functional languages, I picked Haskell there, for example, but there are others as well as functional philosophies, where you build a piece of code that doesn't hold state in it. So why do we do this? It lets us reason about complex systems in ways that you can't reason about well if you have effects from the past as well as effects going forward that you need to think about at the same time. And this lets us reduce cost, improve reliability, but also helps us reduce risk. And we'll talk about security implications mostly here, but we'll talk about some of the other benefits as well. So when we start thinking what this means in terms of infrastructure, if we go back to the way IT worked in 20 years ago for everybody, and still the way a lot of the world works, you rarely go build out a server. When your capacity is too low, you might go add one server. And then for basically the rest of your career, you are doing the care and feeding of that server. You're upgrading it, you're maintaining it, you're praying it doesn't crash. When it crashes, you start a new career somewhere else and you go repeat the same thing. And it's very rare that you also destroy hardware. You maybe eventually decide that the hardware is so obsolete that you're going to go buy a new box or something fails catastrophically, but really you spend all of your time in that maintenance process window. When we think about ephemeral infrastructure, our mindset shifts completely. So here the cycle is one where we create something, we use it for a little bit, and then we destroy it. So the sort of key actions around creation and destruction occur very, very frequently and kind of whenever we want. So if our load spikes a bit, we go create some more infrastructure. When the load falls to save money, we will go and throw that infrastructure away. We will also not think about the upgrade process in the same way. So instead of thinking about, here is the server that customers are using, I am going to go do some downtime and upgrade it and pray that nothing crashes, instead I will take an instance down, install a new one with the new version on it, and transfer my load over to that. So this is a very different mindset in terms of how we create our infrastructure.
Okay, so let's talk about different mindsets in getting there. Before I do that, I just want to shill for the Joel Wallenstrom audiovisual consulting services. If you ever have problems with your slides during a presentation, I can come in and fix them for you. And also, Paul and I were talking, if anybody has questions during this, feel free to raise a hand. We can do it afterwards as well.
Or actually, come up to the mic if you have a question, because I can't see you very well.
And so I'm obviously like audience participation. Who here's heard of, knows of Chaos Monkey and Simian Army? Okay, so good. Relatively large part of this audience. And so before I came to the world of ephemeral communications computing way of thinking, this was one of the things that really motivated me, because this is, you know, I'm kind of like a nerd fanboy of what happened at Netflix here. But, you know, I can only imagine being in that room when people said, and so for those of you who don't know Chaos Monkey, there was a meeting room, obviously at some point in time, where somebody said, you know what we ought to do? because we can't get the reliability numbers we want, we ought to unleash tools that randomly tear down instances in production. I mean, so as somebody who's done a lot of testing in production, you know, or a lot of testing, we're often not allowed to be in production. Like financial services, you know, big companies typically don't like you poking into their production environment. So for somebody to say specifically, you know what we ought to do, let's do this and tear things down and make your jobs and your weekends ostensibly more difficult, obviously didn't, you know, I don't think all the hands went up all at the same time. But there's a shift in thinking that is like ephemeral thinking. And it was important here because what happened, what they were trying to do is they were saying, we can't get to the number of nines reliability we want because every time we model this and every time we test for reliability, the thing that bites us in the ass at the end is randomness and the chaos that kind of comes in the network. So let's create that so that we can build resiliency around that. So they released their monkey on their pipes. You know, you just imagine, you know, randomness and monkeys being released and pipes being broken, right? Now, as somebody who's kind of promoting, not kind of, I am promoting this ephemeral way of thinking. On the right side, what I'm trying to indicate there is certainly in that room, they didn't say, let's go after data or let's go after things that we can never recover from. You know, there you have to take a guarded, gradual approach to this. That is for sure, but it is a change in mindset. And it just goes back to what I was saying. The persistent mindset is, I think, what most of us are used to. You know, I'm overseeing critical infrastructure. If you were to release Chaos Monkey into my environment, I'm worried I'd get fired. I'm worried we might get arrested. I don't know. There's heavy consequences around doing this in some circumstances. But if you're not actually switching to understand that this chaos is inevitable, or in the case of data, that data acquisition by adversaries is inevitable, then you're going to get stuck in this old persistent mindset. And so, you know, one of the takeaways from this talk, and what we're hopefully going to give you historical background and technical background, is, you know, sort of the motivation to say, I've got to get me and my team to think a little bit more in that ephemeral mindset, because finding and fixing problems is the game we're all in, right? Like that's what's important for us. Now, a funny thing happened on the way to Chaos Monkey, and that was, this was all reliability, but there were security benefits that were real and important. And so as security people, I think that's why so many hands went up. You know, if you're an attacker and somebody's going to try and tear down an instance, who cares, right? Like, we built this system to be resilient to that. If somebody's going to go try and corrupt data in that instance, well, that data is only as long as that instance. And certainly if you're going to try and exfil data, you have a very limited, that persistence in the APT has been really hamstrung, right? So shifting to this mindset, I don't think we want to understate that it can be difficult to get there, but I think it's an important place to go. And so that, you know, that's the Netflix case, but Paul, I'm going to pass it over to you to think about other areas and places. I went backwards, you got to go forward.
So, and actually one other thing about the security benefit, which is that if you build your architecture in a way that you're only putting the data that a given instance needs, your risk gets reduced a lot. Like, if the instance that is serving me as a customer only has my customer data on it, and I exfiltrate the data off that instance and I see my own data, that's a lot less serious than if everybody's data is on the same machine as doing everybody's computation. So when you think about ephemeral infrastructure, it's a shift in mindset, but it's one that people have kind of come around to. So if you, at least within kind of the elite companies that are building new technology, so if you go to Google or Facebook, everybody's thinking this way. And it's working its way down sort of into becoming more mainstream. When we talk about applying the same philosophy to data, we also find that in the same way as infrastructure, this is both cutting edge as well as a really, really ancient idea. And when I say it's ancient, for example, if we talk about speech, you know, absent technology present in this room, my conversation with you would be ephemeral. Your eyes looking at me, again, absent a camera in this room, are going to see something ephemeral that's occurring. So things like telephone are also intended to be ephemeral for various regulatory reasons as well as technological ones. We also see ephemerality of data in storage. So many of you probably have a box in your office that says, you know, put your stuff here that you don't want anymore, and there's a shred by date on it. Or your paperwork associated with your tax returns, you stick them in a box, you need to keep it for 7 years in case you get audited, but you actually want to shred it at the end of that time in order to get either security benefits or just because you don't want to pay for the storage and manage that anymore. So there are different reasons that we used to have ephemerality in the past, and they were usually driven by either some kind of technological limit. Storing data was expensive and difficult when you have to, so you simply didn't do it. You know, capturing the audio back in the time when our Constitution was written was really hard. You might have to, you know, lie underneath somebody's house to hear the conversation. And that's partly why questions of privacy were less of concern to the founders than they might have been, because they just didn't have the same threats that we have today. But there were still security reasons and privacy reasons people did worry about then around how they managed information as well. So when we think about data ephemerality, though, we have a challenge that we don't have for infrastructure. With your infrastructure, you don't just have a million PCs automatically being created by accident and just sort of sitting everywhere. But with data ephemerality, copying ends up being kind of a problem, because you don't have it's not as easy to know where your data is and who has copies of it. But we have, at the same time, one really, really, really huge and critical advantage when we're trying to build data ephemerality that we don't have for infrastructure, which is cryptography. You can't go and encrypt random computers sitting around, and maybe homomorphic encryption will change that someday, but for the most part, that's not an option available. But when we're dealing with data, we can encrypt it. And that lets us do a number of things. Symmetric cryptography lets us greatly simplify destruction, because we can encrypt some data and then delete the key. And once the key is gone, essentially the data is gone, because it's computationally infeasible to recover it. And it also greatly simplifies transport, because I can send my data out onto a network, and the packets that I send may go all over the place in the network. They may be recorded. I don't need to care about that network in the same way that I would have to care about it if I didn't have symmetric cryptography. Public key cryptography also plays a really critical role. And I'm not going to go into all of its benefits here, but I do want to highlight one in particular, which is what I call cold storage. And the idea here is that you can encrypt your data with a public key whose private key is offline. So if we think about the life cycle for infrastructure, we have a creation process. For ephemeral infrastructure, we have a creation process, we have a time when we're actively using it, and then we have a destruction point. But with data, we can add this extra step. We create, we use it for a while. We can then put it into cold storage, and if we want to, we can bring it back out of cold storage if there's a big need, although that's not your plan. And then finally, a deletion process. So this is really important when you're trying to get, for example, buy-in in a corporate environment, saying, you know, going to somebody and saying, let's just nuke every file that hasn't been used in the last 3 years. You're probably going to get some people raising their hands and saying, what if something really useful is there? But if you say, let's put all the files we haven't used in for 3 years in cold storage. If we find that we need something, we can always undo it by going to the safety deposit box and pulling the key out, but it's going to be encrypted in a way where it's as good as gone to somebody who doesn't physically get possession of this key that we're not going to keep online anywhere. That's an easier conversation to have.
So I think a interesting real-world example of that is when people have recently, probably post-Podesta, imposed email retention policies, especially on senior management, right? And all of a sudden, it's not there. I can't operate if it's not there, but you give this little safety net of, no, look, if it's really important, I've got this thing for you for X number of days. My experience has been, once you give that assurance, they don't ask for it anymore, right? Like, you know, the normalcy of that process takes over, but you just need that safety net sometimes in a corporate setting. Sorry.
So who here has a public storage unit? Like, and basically, that's a place where you go stick stuff to die. If you're lucky, all your stuff will get stolen or it will get flooded, and you have to pay the fee for it anymore. Basically, the worst case is that you have to hang on to your stuff and pay for it forever. And the same thing happens with data, because you put it in cold storage, people forget about it. And so what you want to do when you put the data in cold storage is say, look, if we haven't needed this after 3 years, we're going to destroy it. So it's an interim step on the way to deletion. It's not something where you want to leave it there forever any more than you want to have your great-great-grandchildren paying for your public storage unit that has, you know, your baby clothes or whatever in it. So you want to plan for destruction as your default, but with cold storage, it gives you a plan B if you need to. And some examples of data that are really well amenable to the cold storage approach include user data that's not been touched recently. So, you know, the files that are sitting on your laptop that you've not used in the last 4 years that may well contain PII or other sensitive data, probably don't need to have those as readily available. Another thing that's really useful is to encrypt log files as you create them. So there are lots of times you're creating log data, which may well have sensitive data either intentionally stored in it or leaking into it, which you don't want to have available to an adversary who breaks into the instance that's creating that log data. But if you build a system where you use public key cryptography to encrypt those logs as they're being created, the machine creating the logs only needs to have basically the public key. And the encrypted ciphertext gets accumulated. If somebody breaks into the system, if there's a crisis, you can go back and get that data. But the machine that's producing the logs doesn't have the decryption key on it. And that's one of the really critical attributes of a good cold storage system, which is that those recovery keys are stored in a much, much safer place than the place where the encryption is being done. Doing this for your backups is also really useful. Unfortunately, a lot of backup systems right now still use symmetric keys. So the machine being backed up has the key on it that can break its backups and perhaps all the backups of all the other machines using the same keys. Terrible idea. You want your backup system to take a public key and have the recovery use a corresponding private key. This is 1970s technology, but it just takes a little while for these things to percolate into the market. But if you're talking to a vendor, make sure your backups use asymmetric cryptography. And then regulatory compliance, we'll talk about in just a minute.
So on this slide, you know, I do want to kind of point out Paul's, you know, comment that you hope your storage unit gets flooded, right? This is a responsible way to deal, especially with compliance issues and real business issues, et cetera. But my tinfoil hat friends would say, when you put something in storage, they're still on attack surface, right? So, you know, there is risk associated with doing this, but I think this is a trade-off we want to take because it gives us the ability to start reducing our footprint. Yeah.
So I'm kind of curious on your thoughts when it comes to like database credentials and ephemerality.
Yeah.
So you have that scale that needs the password.
Right.
But it still has to access the database, especially from the compliance side.
Well, it depends. I mean, again, ephemerality is a microsecond to 7 years. I mean, I think it can be engineered so that you can kind of not lose whatever you want, but you can keep those in a safe place where you have encryption protecting them node to node, right? Does that answer your question, or?
Yeah, for the most part, I've died on that hill 12 times.
Yeah, and I understand that, absolutely. I mean, especially given what, you know, my product does, I've been on that hill with people, you know? And so a lot of what I think is, there are a lot of blunt objects out there in the world of ephemeral key management, and I don't think blunt objects are what you need. I think you need to be able to manage them and have flexibility for individual use cases. That'd be my take there.
There's actually a really good point here, which I want to highlight, which is that as you're encrypting your data, you want to make sure your key management plan roughly corresponds to how you think you might want to delete the data. Because if all of it's encrypted with the same public-private key pair, it's hard to destroy that key. So you might want to have monthly keys for different tasks or try to figure out some way. There's at least some logic there. Deletion isn't usually a very, very finely timed event. If it is, there are cryptographic techniques that you can use that are more sophisticated, but the easy, straightforward stuff can solve 90% of the problem. So for most cases, you don't need to do anything fancy.
Yeah, so, all right. Again, not a cryptographer. And so I'm gonna go back to this next slide and talk a little bit about, Paul just talked about how it can be done. So this is the cool thing. Again, before I got into the seat I'm in now, I thought, look, we have math that can make this happen. There's automation, orchestration around this process that really hasn't existed before. But there are a lot of issues around how can you do it in a compliance setting? And realistically, it's also how can you do it in a moral and ethical and doing it the right way? Like there's a lot of debate over how this can be done because it's hiding things, but it's not. This is how we've been dealing with communications and data for a long time. So as a non-cryptographer historian, Abraham Lincoln's my hero, right? And he was an adopter of technology unlike most of our presidents. It just happened to be the telegram. He was, you know, really rabid in the use of technology. He was also very, very conscious of the importance of his data and what sort of historical impact that would have, what it would have on his legacy. So I don't know, I was gonna do a raise of hands. Anyone here of the Lincoln drawer, the concept of a Lincoln drawer? Okay, so nobody. What he would do is he would write his emails, essentially, and he would stick them in the drawer of his desk and let them percolate for 3 days. And then he would bring them back out and say, do I want to put this out there in the world? And if he didn't, he burned it. And if he did, it became part of history. And so, you know, this is the way corporately we've done things in the past. This is the way we've done things. You know, there are burn bags and file boxes and everything that Paul talks about. It's a very normal way to handle your information. Right now we have, let's say, world leaders who maybe don't have a drawer where they put ideas. and they get out there immediately. And that may not be something that we all embrace as being the best use of that data, nor for the legacy of our country or for that person, right? So, you know, now is the time. It's a really, you know, I don't want to get like too caught up into what Snapchat does. I want to get caught up into how people should be handling really important data, whether that be communications, files, whatever the case may be.
Although years ago, I did have an employee who had wrote something down he didn't want to have, and he decided it was a good idea to burn it in his hotel room. So comply with fire code if you're going with Lincoln's approach, just as a little
The RSA conference does not condone burning of large amounts of paper in your hotel room this week. But so with that sort of background of it being the right thing to do, and if, you know, if I can get you to that place where, all right, so how do I do this? You know, beyond just it being the right thing to do, now there are some external forces that are going to tell us we have to do this, right? And those are going to be retention obligations, and we're also, which we are all very used to, especially if anyone here is in financial services, healthcare, et cetera. There are numbers that we have to hit, right? Not so much on the deletion side, historically. My companies always had deletion requirements. We would have trade secrets, intellectual property, and so we would have master service agreements and NDAs and things that forced us to wipe all client data. So, you know, it comes up in business, certainly, but there weren't very many regulations that were starting to say, you have to delete data. I think about, you know, what's being debated in Sacramento today, and telling Facebook that if I decide not to have a Facebook account, you have to give me proof that you've deleted all my data. I mean, I think that's an ambition that is great, but I don't know how that gets accomplished. I really don't. I think when we use cryptography on the front end, we do. We can do that. This can be a process that's attainable. So GDPR is the start, right? California is the next step. We're not quite there, you know. What did Google swallow? A $57 million GDPR fine, and that was like sweet.
3 hours of revenue.
Yeah, like 3 hours of revenue and like the toilet paper budget for June. They're okay with that. They're gonna do okay.
Hopefully, bought toilet paper somewhere else.
Right, so. Exactly. But it's coming, right? Like this is a thing that's coming, and so people are gonna have to understand how do we deal with this data. I also think, and Paul sort of hit on this before. There is a liability. We're going to get into this right now in terms of how these trends are pushing. But think about Netflix again. You know, they want to know that Joel Wallenstrom binge watches Gilmore Girls on Saturdays once for a moment, and then they aggregate that, and then they don't want any of that liability associated with my personal information and my personal behavior. There's a lot that they can do with that after that first minute. There's a lot of pain that is associated with restoring that data past that first minute. And so that's what I think a lot of these regulations are eventually gonna be pushing companies and understanding, is that we need to have a systematic way to deal with this.
Also, when you're thinking about ephemerality, there are different triggers that you're gonna run into. So sometimes the trigger is based on time, like you are required to keep something for no more than X years, but there are other triggers that can come along too. And one that probably all of you have contractually incurred but maybe not complied with is in your standard NDA. It says that when the NDA is over or terminated or expires, you will delete all copies of the data that you received under it. But going through and actually ensuring compliance with that, especially when you count things like backup tapes and employee laptops and email systems, if you haven't made any plans for how you're going to ultimately deal with that at the end, probably isn't very practical. But we're seeing regulatory requirements that say that you have to be able to do this. The GDPR is the first. There are going to be more of these. So this isn't something where, you know, even if you're not doing this because you want to, you're going to end up having to do this because you have to.
My anecdote there is, you know, in my old businesses, it would always be a customer asking me for that information, and I would say, well, I'm sorry, I can't do that because we had an agreement that I had to wipe everything. And then a salesperson would be like, I got it. And they'd send it off to him just like, oh, every time it seemed to happen. So go ahead.
So there's a couple of historical trends that I want to highlight that really are explaining why we're thinking about this problem now in a way that was different from the way we were a few years ago, which might also be different from the way it was 50 years ago. So we have one trend, which is that technology costs are falling exponentially. So the cost of storage for most applications now is a rounding error or not even registering. There are a few places where it's different from that, but for most places, we don't care. Some other costs aren't falling, like the cost of maintaining legal compliance and regulatory overhead. the pain that can be inflicted on you when a discovery process comes along and somebody cherry picks the three most embarrassing emails that were sent amongst your 10,000 employees. You know, these kinds of things roughly stay constant. But then we have a growth curve in the security costs that we have for holding risky things around. Now, security costs are hard to budget. You know, if you were Mondelez, you probably didn't plan on having the NotPetya attack come along and wipe out all your systems. It's one of these things where you get these rare extreme events that occur, and when they do occur, you have brand risks and regulatory risks, and they're much messier than something that you write a check for on a continuous basis every week or every quarter. It's also hard to allocate security risk because often the entity that controls the risk and the entity that bears the risk are different, and there are some things that are hard to quantify. But if we think about just like the recent Singaporean HIV database leak, I mean, this is an example where the storage cost for the copies of this information are completely negligible. You could have millions of copies of a 14,000 person database and it wouldn't register. But the personal impact for people whose privacy has been violated is really, really substantial. There's a big human cost here, which brings in all sorts of ethical and legal and regulatory issues. Again, hard to monetize something like, to map something like that to dollars, but there certainly is a very, very important dimension to being able to keep data in the places we want it and not have it in other places and be able to destroy it when somebody doesn't need that data anymore.
And so what I would say is it's hard to map that, but that's what we're here to do. And so this is, you know, how do you take that example and bring it back to work and say, I've got a really good rational structure for making this decision as to where, when I want to eliminate data and use ephemerality?
Yeah, so if we think about just sort of the historical trends, so for the x-axis here, history is just no numbers, this is just kind of concepts. But if we think about the benefits of information roughly staying constant over time, but the storage cost has been falling. In turn, we've had this rising security cost. So if we think about the actual value of some information that I have today, it's the benefit it will give me minus the storage cost minus that security cost. So we end up with a curve that looks like this, where in the early stages, security costs dominated and it was not worth storing certain things. You know, capturing, when I have to hire monks to make copies of books, there's gonna be a limit to the number of copies that I'm gonna rationally make. There's then an era where we have, we were in an era where it was worth archiving data because the security costs were low and the storage costs were low. And then we reach a point where it's no longer rational to be holding this stuff forever. So long time ago, we were in the period where we had relatively little amounts of data being stored. We were in this green wind era for a while. We are, depending on the application, either entering or now in, I would argue, this red area on the right where there are large amounts of data that we should no longer be retaining and certainly not keeping on active servers where they can decrypt the information. So I'm now going to talk about a couple of real-world examples. So in the company I used to run cryptography research, we would do engineering projects on sensitive stuff that we cared about. And one of the sort of the old way of doing development is you have people do development on their laptops or a regular PC with local storage. And this creates a lot of problems. PCs get lost and stolen, data come in and out through USB ports. And it's also kind of a cost problem because most of the storage and CPU cycles are being wasted. So what we did is we shifted some of the engineering project over to a model where basically the engineers would work from a thin client that didn't hold any of their project information locally. They would have a screen and a keyboard and a mouse, and those would go through the network to a server that was close by. It did all of the compilation jobs. It actually rendered the desktops, and they just went over the local network. And we found that this both gave some security benefits, which were very large, because you no longer had your data floating around on random engineers' USB sticks and things, but it also improved things like compile times, because instead of waiting for their local machine to compile, suddenly we had some servers that were able to do that for them. There is one annoying issue that I'd like some of you to work on, which was the speed of light. Mm-hmm. For the India team, the speed of light was kind of a problem because there was some latency there. So it doesn't scale, unfortunately, across the whole globe in the way that you might like. But it works really well, and it's something anybody can do with relatively little effort. Another example is in many companies right now, you go and you try to build a list of the bad websites, and you block them, and you have a list of either the good websites or everywhere else that employees are allowed to go to. And this surprisingly doesn't work very well. It's hopeless to list all the bad ones. There are bad sites that employees need to visit. There are good sites that are risky, like is a gigabyte going up the Dropbox good or bad? When you can't block Dropbox because it's part of your probably corporate stuff, but you don't know where it's going and it's all encrypted with SSL. So instead, what you can do is you can actually run the browser somewhere else on a sacrificial ephemeral instance, and you can let the employee do what they want and then kill the instance. And you can build a system that does this pretty easily with just open source, or you can do commercial offerings that can do this. But like for this, as I was putting this together, I decided that I was going to try to think of what is the most dangerous thing that I could search for. And I decided that double your Bitcoin free money was probably the worst thing to go browse for while clicking on stuff, while running an ancient version of Firefox that's got a whole bunch of known vulnerabilities. So I went and I browsed there, but I did it from my laptop going to an AWS instance where I was running the browser, and I clicked on stuff and I downloaded some stuff and I ran it and then I killed the instance. Now, if you were to go do the same thing, which is on your regular machine, your machine would be absolutely toast. So here I was able to get the thing done that I was trying to do. I could go and learn about how to double my Bitcoin and get free money, and I didn't take any unreasonable risk. So trying to figure out ways that you can let people do things ephemerally but not have consequences is part of the benefit of this kind of a mindset as you build infrastructures.
Okay, we're kind of tight on time, so I'm going to make this fast. Who here, show of hands, has worked at a company where people have had trouble managing servers? Okay, great.
Somebody works for an Amish farm over
right,
there.
Right, exactly. And who's had trouble with maybe protecting email or communications products in the past, right? This is what we're doing, right? So ephemeral messaging, this is what we're doing. And so this is a good slide for me. The next slide is where I could really shill, so I'm going to give that to Paul. But look, we're just trusted entities in your communications. You know, we lived in a world where it was every node. We had to trust every node. We all lived in that in a corporate space. A lot of you probably still do, right? This is just SMS, right? We can today, what is very normal is we reduce that down to 4, right? We've kind of taken out maybe the mobile provider, but we're still sender, recipient, server, and cloud provider have to be trusted in this. When you use ephemeral messaging, you can limit it to 2. It can just be the sender and the recipient. That server issue is gone. So as somebody who was an attacker for 15 years, that's really compelling to me. Take that away. Take that out of there. Take the cloud provider out of there. Cloud providers are not a problem necessarily. It's usually our management of the technology, but it's still one more thing. I will inject one more trusted entity if you need to use an ephemeral messaging tool and you need to have compliance. Now you're going to end up doing something different with different key management, but there will be that third trusted entity. Okay? So let's talk about keys.
So cryptographically, you'll hear terms of forward secrecy and future secrecy. So the idea here is that you have short-lived keys so that a compromise today doesn't expose the past. There's also the notion of future secrecy, where a compromise, once it's been cleaned up or the attacker has left, doesn't compromise the future. And there are some cryptographic algorithms that tend to provide this fairly naturally, like the Diffie-Hellman key exchange protocol is one where you generate some random keys, you use them, and you can throw those away. Others tend to not work quite as well with this, like RSA tends to be used in modes where you have longer-lived keys. But many protocols already have these attributes. So the TLS, the most popularly used cipher suites now have this. There's been a shift over the last few years toward those. A lot of messaging protocols have it, so Signal, WhatsApp, Wickr, and other protocols as well. So looking to get these attributes in the cryptographic systems makes it that much easier to build the properties that you want in the overall infrastructure using them.
All right, so knowing that this is all possible, and very much in the vein of RSA, we're going to get into the apply. This is the take home. What can you guys do about this?
Yeah, so I think when you look at trying to use ephemerality infrastructure, I mean, your goal is to minimize non-ephemeral infrastructure. You're going to still have some things that you need to have around. It's not that you're going to get 100%, but the distance that you make is all goodness and helps you enormously. And so you want to pick the low-hanging fruit, places where you get the biggest reward most quickly. So you want to look for places where you have risky operations that can be compartmentalized. So for example, transforming user supply data into some other form is an example of something where you want to compartmentalize the data from one user into a throwaway instance and then work with it instead of running that in a place that has every user's data. You also want to look for places where compute, storage, and network all scale differently. So if you're finding that those scale at different rates, there are probably both some security and also cost and reliability benefits that you can get. So when you do this, you're going to look at a number of factors. You're going to look at the change in security risk that you get, both on a sort of per node basis as well as across the entire service. There are some pluses and minuses. So as you go from an environment where you have security that's been tailored for a particular task, you know, you have the server that's got, you know, the gold-plated case around it that you've really thought a lot about, and you switch that over to Amazon's cloud instance, Amazon overall probably does a better job than you do, but they've not customized it to your particular workload. And you'll also find that there may be some centralized failure modes that are terrifying, like all instances of everybody in the world running on AWS may go down at the same time. And so if, for example, our ability to produce food goes away, we care a lot if all of our farms go away, but we probably don't care about if 1 acre has trouble. So the failure modes look very different. So scalability, reliability, reengineering effort, operational cost at plan scale. You want to think about all these things and then go architect it, implement it, verify it, and launch the monkeys at the system you just built.
Okay, and so I'm going to talk about how to take some of this away and apply it to data. So first of all, it's attacking that complexity that you have to manage. And I know, and I have empathy for people who are on security teams here.
Empathy.
Yeah, well, look, it's always been about, I need to protect more, I need a bigger budget, I need a bigger team, there's more stuff, I need a bigger budget, I need more, it's a bigger team. And there's something to be said for that. Like, that's building an org and that's building a career, et cetera. And so there's something somewhat antithetical to saying, I want to have less, right? But when we have customers, you know, a good example, what happens oftentimes is we have a really good team that's managing this communications product or collaboration tool. And we've got it where we want it to be. And then 6 months later, a contractor's come in and they're overseeing it and it just gets away from them. And so the simplicity is the thing that makes this easy in the long run. In the short run, find the red, right? We all have it. Like Paul's talk about how we look at these costs and the risks associated with data. We all have the red, whether it's really sensitive communications in email, files on desktops. Right. This is what I see. This is not all just, you know, Wickr related stuff. But in my world, people would take those really simple steps and say, that's it. We're just going to get information off desktops. We're going to have the week of doing this. And we're going to take all that data. We're going to put it somewhere central. We're going to understand who wants it, who accesses it, how important this is to the business. So it can get really, I see companies get very, very sideways on this. They might get excited about, oh, data ephemerality, I'm gonna do this. Okay, I gotta change my information governance policies. Oh wait, what about our data classification? We gotta update that. And all of a sudden there are subcommittees to committees around how to deal with data that are being formed in order to take a first step. It's almost inevitable. And so don't do that. Don't try and solve it all at the first time. Find that one thing that you can go back and sit around that room. You know, it's not Chaos Monkey. You're like, hey, you know what we ought to do? Let's clean PII off desktops. What do you think? And there aren't going to be any hands that go up and say, that's a stupid idea, Jim. You're fired. So do that one thing. And when you do it, you start making this like cascading snowball effect. You've made that one change. That informs how you guys all understand that data. Once you have that information, it goes right into your business needs. Like, whoa, wait, we need to treat this in a certain way. So I'm now understanding the data. I understand what it means to our business. And now you're informing policy in a way that you, don't have to have subcommittees to subcommittees. It's just there. Like, we're treating this data this way because this is how the business uses it. And now we're updating our policy around that. And then you're afforded the opportunity also to not go back as like the security wonk who's like, we've got to treat our data differently. You have a real rational business case for why we're doing this. So you can go back to the business and say, from a more of a risk management approach rather than just a bit flipping approach, hey, look, we're handling this differently because of these needs that you've given to us. Our policies have changed. And then you just implement. And it's very cyclical. You can use things to automate this, right? This is where cryptography becomes great. You enforce it with strong key management. Next thing you know, you are deleting data mathematically. You're not making a, it's not a weekend project to say, what we really need to do is go clean things up, because that never happens. We all want, that's like cleaning out your self-storage locker. It just doesn't happen, right? So you're creating these automated processes, and it's not Chaos Monkey, but it's a similar thing where you're just creating a machine that does this.
And I think we actually forgot the last step, which is to take credit, because when a breach occurs and the data wasn't there, it was in cold storage, you can take credit for having saved your company an enormous amount of pain. And there will be breaches, there will be laptops that people install stuff on, and maybe then you'll use that as the justification to, for example, switch your browsing to some kind of an ephemeral mode, or switch your messaging to something ephemeral, or switch your development processes to something where the end machine only holds ephemeral data. So there's lots of places you can, again, think about using this philosophy. This isn't a, like, religion. It's an approach you can use to gain some benefits. Using it in the right places is good. Using it in the wrong places is bad. So maybe it is like religion. I don't know. but it's a tool that you can use as you think about systems. So we're out of time. Can we take a question anyway? If anybody wants to come up to the microphones.
If there aren't questions, go ahead. Yeah.
Unrelated, almost. Yeah. Given the actual fundamental importance of this for the very way in which we think about cybersecurity, almost rhetorical, in fact, why aren't we more of us in the room? I mean, there's a lot of attendance downstairs. And this is talking about fundamental things like Git approach.
Yeah.
Never mind the subtle differences between bar and PMP and FHS and stuff that existed.
Sure. Because of Paul.
Well, so if you found this useful, on the form, fill out the session surveys. If you didn't think it was useful, just say that you went to a talk about Facebook coin and blockchain going on.
So, and a serious answer to that is from a Wickr standpoint, like, we have a lot of corporate customers coming to us saying, I want to figure out how to do this. Oftentimes an incident response, right? Makes sense. Out of band communications, you handle logs and communications differently. But generally, the security practitioner is thinking about orchestration and speed right now. It's not a security thing. I'm not saying it makes sense necessarily, but speed is important. And look, it used to be that people, 10 years ago, it was a checklist of 10 things to do. And the fact that we have all this great orchestration and people are, using the appropriate webhooks to automate processes is pretty cool. I think this is the next wave. People are now, when they come to us, they're now trying to layer security back across that, that process they've orchestrated in Gmail, which they understand. I mean, the irony of that is not lost on most of the people I talk to, but really they just had to get from point A to B first, and then they have to improve the process. So I think it's some of that.
We're also entering that red phase in the right kind of, it's not like an instant transition where everybody realizes that the world shifted a little bit. And as we move further over there, at least, the reason we thought this was a useful talk to give is this is a mindset that gives big benefits. It's applicable in a lot of ways. So I hope you'll think about the question of whether you can do something useful with it. Oh, one more question. Yes.
Have you all thought into the space of, like, zero data systems where you're encrypting data at, say, the customer, where they have the cryptography, they have, it's like a pairwise master key where they have the key, and then when they don't want to, like, if I have, I work for Expedia. Mm-hmm.
Right, or you have because the customer has multiple devices that come and go and some needs for continuity. But if you look at, I think right now, the ephemeral messaging systems do this the best. And so in the consumer space, Signal, Wickr in the business space, like if you kind of look at what they've done there, giving customers control over data, but also the ability to, when necessary, comply with regulatory retention restrictions and things. There's some pretty deep thinking that's gone on there. I think it has not percolated into other applications as much. But one of the key things that you're describing, or maybe the two things, one is putting customers in control of deletion, and that works in some places, maybe not. The other thing about getting most of the machines out of that trust model. So if the customer is encrypting the data and decrypting the data and you can't do that, it means that you can't screw up, and you can trust hardware that you might not otherwise trust. You can trust services. You don't have to worry about them as much. And trust doesn't mean necessarily the company running them is good or bad. It just means that there might be an operational mistake or a configuration error or something that causes that machine to be breached. And if the data on it is encrypted, then you have much, much lower risk as a result than if it's not.
I like to trust math more than configurations, right?
So I'm thinking about like JWT with JWP, and you have certain data elements within a transaction, and you're moving everything more and more to the DOM, to where like Node.js and everything, like everything is starting to run in the DOM on the client. And if you're able to mathematically and cryptography, use cryptography to send the data over in a state that has non-repudiation, it seems to me to try to get out of data as much as possible.
And some fields, like a credit card field, absolutely encrypt it with a public key on the client, and then all your servers are unable to decrypt it, and then either your acquirer or maybe your final payment processor can decrypt it. There is absolutely no downside to doing that.
Yeah, it's all about data elements, not the whole.
I'm here not to shill, but yeah, that's very emblematic of what we're trying to accomplish. To your question again, I mean, I think, you know, at ISEC Partners, early days, we were pushing SSL, right? And the industry pushed back and said, you're crazy. There's too much overhead. This will never happen. You know, this is just what happens. Like, people are afraid of change, and people are afraid of added performance hits, and people are afraid of any weight that you put on things. And so I think the industry is just learning. A very practical, a little shout out, although I don't know exactly how they do their deletion, but you can see maturity in Zendesk's data deletion policy. That is something, you know, it's on their website, I think is worth looking at. It's provocative for me. They're very thoughtful about how data is deleted as soon as you cancel your contract with them. And so I think that's important, is that everything shifts to the red for them immediately, right? Like, you've decided not to be a Zendesk customer anymore, and they're like, well, that's it. I got to get rid of everything. And I'm going to do so on this time frame, and that's it. That's how we're dealing with this, because this asset just became a liability. On their technological balance sheet, it just happens immediately with a phone call. And so it doesn't happen that fast for all of us necessarily, but that's ultimately what, you know, that was the Netflixian thing I was saying. You know, my information becomes not valuable really fast. It's valuable in the aggregate.
That makes you want to be able, I mean, then you can go try a service like that. It actually empowers customers, because if the consequence of using Facebook is that they will track you for the rest of your life and you have no idea where that leads, that's a very different customer risk than if it's something where I'm going to go try something, see what the benefit is, and only use that for as long as it's helping me out.
I got to believe we're pretty far over.
Yep. Awesome. Thank you so much for coming. Enjoy your conference.
Thanks, everyone. All right.